in town. Brings on the volley! And what a goal!
Unbelievable piece of football.
It's Wes Morgan again! Body! Well, as you like.
It's just nothing other than sublime.
Live on lcfc.com, Facebook and Twitter. You're listening to Extra Time on LCFC Radio.
Hello and welcome to LCFC Radio's Extra Time. Good evening, everybody that's listening in and has joined us just before the new year. And we've got a fantastic panel with us as ever on Extra Time this evening. We've got Gerry Taggart sat opposite me, Iwan Roberts to my left-hand side, and hopefully dialed in over the phone, we've got Tony Cottee as well. Evening, Tony.
Evening, Dan. Evening, Iwan. Evening,
TC. Evening, TC.
I'm really good, thanks.
Good man. Lovely to hear that, my friend.
How are you two as well? Obviously, it's a win that we can talk about for Leicester, Gerry. We haven't been able to do that after the last three games.
Mm.
So it's a positive now that Leicester have got back to winning ways.
Yeah, it's a great win. I'm sorry to say this, Tony, but against a really, really, really poor West Ham side, you have to say. But that's neither here nor there. A massive call from Brendan Rodgers to change nine players. Like, that, literally your whole squad. Kept this, probably his two most experienced players in the team, and changed everybody else. You could say that, you know, with the likes of Christian and Wes coming in, it's neither here nor there, either. But a big call from Brendan, and he got the rewards for doing that. They looked a little bit fresher.
Yeah, we've got a very busy show coming up on Extra Time here. We'll listen back to the best bits of that win. We'll hear from Brendan Rodgers, Kelechi Iheanacho and Damari Gray. We've got our last Fox standing. We'll look back at some of Leicester's best moments of the last decade as the 2010s come to a close. But before we do any of that, Tony, obviously Gerry's just alluded to the fact there, West Ham is a massive part of you, your career, your life, and they just weren't very good, were they, at the weekend, I think it's fair to say.
No, I'd done the game in the studio for Sky, Dan, and they was dreadful, West Ham. Absolutely dreadful. I mean, defensively, they was all over the place. Going forward, they didn't ever really look like they was going to score too many goals. And obviously the inevitables happened there in terms of changing the manager, and they've brought in David Moyes, which I must say I'm really pleased about. He's a good guy, and I thought he was a bit harshly treated last time, so I think it's a good appointment for the club. But I think that was just the final straw. It was a really poor performance by West Ham, but having said all that, like I said, I was really pleased with how Leicester played, especially after the disappointment of not getting that many points in the previous three games. It was a fantastic 3 points for Leicester.
Yeah, we'll talk a little bit more about West Ham and that appointment of David Moyes later on in Extra Time here on LCFC Radio. But Iwan, finally, before we listen back to that game, as Gerry says, important to get back to winning ways for Leicester.
Oh, when you've lost back-to-back games for the first time this season, it's important to get back to winning ways. And probably West Ham were the team to play. Couldn't have come at a better time for Leicester, in my opinion. And it was a brave call, because it was obviously a pre-planned thing that Brendan was going to make all these changes with so many games over the Christmas period, and such an important week coming up this week for the club, and obviously next week with the first leg of the cup game against Aston Villa. So it was a brave call. He could quite easily have changed his mind and stuck with the big guns, his first team, if you like, just to make sure that he did get
A lot of the other teams did, by the way, in the same, corresponding games. A lot of the managers stuck with the basis of what they would call their strongest element.
So it was a brave call for Brendan to stick to his guns, to think, no, I'm gonna make nine changes, I'm gonna get a bit of freshness. And to be fair to the lads who came in, they showed great fitness levels. Because that's not easy going into a Premier League game. Some of them for the first time. Young Justin at right back, James Justin, came in and did ever so well in his first full debut.
Yeah,
first start. Yeah. Tremendous, absolute tremendous. And just takes, I wouldn't say pressure, because I don't think anybody was under pressure after those. No disgrace in losing to Man City and Liverpool. But no, great response in that good 3 points against West Ham.
Yeah, we'll talk about the busy January that you were alluding to, but a busy December came to an end, of course, at the London Stadium on Saturday. This is how it sounded on Matchday Live.
Two sides making their way out onto the field of play here at the London Stadium, which is just about full. A big bumper crowd in for this final home game of the year for West Ham United. Aldemari Gray with the ball over the top. Iheanacho's on to it straight away. Tries to go past the goalkeeper. Oh, he's taken down. And the referee says penalty to Leicester City.
Red card.
Łukasz Fabianski back in the side today. And a massive error from him straight away. He concedes the penalty with just under 9 minutes gone. And it's a yellow card for the Pole. All three penalties for Leicester this season have been taken by Jamie Vardy. He's missing today, so it's up to Damari Gray instead. Steps up to the ball now, it's Gray! Oh, he's saved by Fabianski! And the rebound is cleared away, and Leicester City don't go in front. It's a save by the goalkeeper. Masuaku's nodding it down, though, still have a chance for Leicester. Flies it towards the far post. Back inside, it's in! Leicester City have scored! Well, that came from nothing there. Everyone thought the ball was going to go out of play, and Kelechi Iheanacho has profited there at the post. Anderson to the right side of Frederick, back to Felipe Anderson. Low ball in, chance for the equaliser, and West Ham United are level. Leicester words ahead for long, and it's been swept into the net from close range by Pablo Fornals. It's been taken quickly. West Ham inside the penalty area, a crossing chance in towards the near post for Ale. Put in for side netting and wide. Well, everyone around us here, including me, I have to say, thought that one had gone in. That is the last action. That is the half-time whistle. Looks like the preferred option here. Five-man more for West Ham. It's going to be Christian Fuchs to drive it under the wall and straight into the arms of Fabianski. Having through the centre, he's still got men to meet. He slips it forward into the area. Real chance for another goal. It's into the net. And Leicester City have the lead for a second time. Damari Gray. What a finish that is from the Leicester City wide man. Morgan still in there. Tries to win the header. Does win the header. Morgan takes it over his own head. Morgan! Oh, he's hit it straight at the goalkeeper. Well, that would have been a goal which should have been played over and over again. Not only in the Morgan household, but plenty of others as well. Nearly set himself up there for a sensational strike. But a claim by Fabianski.
Every step of Leicester City's Premier League campaign. You're listening to LCFC Radio.
Yes, fantastic win at West Ham, of course. Ian says, good evening, everybody. Great 3 points at West Ham. Sharon says, great win. And Addy says, great result after a brave change of players from Brendan Rodgers. But David reminded me, we haven't done the usual post-Christmas stuff of wishing everyone a happy Christmas. Hope you had a good one. But I've David's been. Wished all of you guys.
Bless him. Thank you, David. Yeah, very kind of you.
I burnt everything.
Did you?
I burnt a lot, yeah. But hey-ho.
That's what Christmas is about.
And then I threw it all up and went to bed at half eight. But other than that, it was fantastic.
Yeah, you had a fantastic Christmas then, by the sounds of things, Jerry. Leicester, Tony, finished off that part of the Christmas festive period off with that win, of course. We'll talk a little bit about the Newcastle game on New Year's Day in just a moment. But how important do you think winning down at West Ham was from a Leicester point of view?
That was massive then. It's a strange one. I've touched on this before with cup performances, competitions, is that, you know, you have a squad for a reason because you want those squad players to be ready to come in, be ready for action. And when you've got the opportunity, which Brendan obviously thought it was the right opportunity, you've got to give them a game. But when you throw so many players in, particularly 9 players that, you know, in large, haven't really played too much football this year, you're always going to worry about the performance. And, you know, as I say, I watched the game. I thought Leicester controlled pretty much the whole of the 90 minutes. There was a couple of little times where they wobbled, but in general, it was a really controlled performance. Some really good performances. Ewan touched on James Justin. I thought he'd done well at right back. I thought Chowdhury played well in midfield as well. It was good to see Damari Gray taking his goals as well. So there were some real, real positives for Brendan. And he must have been delighted because he must have known that this was a West Ham team that desperately needed to win the game. I know they were dreadful. I know they were poor. But he must have been worried about making so many changes after the disappointing results. So to get the 3 points, you know, just a massive 3 points for the club.
How pleased will Brendan Rodgers be, Ewan, with that victory? As Tony Cottee was saying just there, that he'll know that West Ham obviously will have been really up for it. They were on a poor run of fixtures themselves. So to go there and to make as many changes as he did, to control the game in the way that Leicester did, in fairness, how pleased will he be?
I think he'll be as satisfied with that performance and that 3 points because of everything that it involved as any other game that they've won this season. The changes going into it, having conceded 7 goals, losing 2 games, needed to get back to winning ways. As I said, it was a perfect game. West Ham in shocking form. I think they'd lost 5 of their previous 6 at the London Stadium, so it's a great time to play them. But that will have given him so much satisfaction. You know, you hear some people after after the defeat to Man City in Liverpool, or the bubbles burst, and you know they're going to drop out the top four and one thing or another. So it was a really, really important victory for Brendan and Leicester.
It was something, Gerry, that you'd underlined and talked about a lot, mainly after that Liverpool game, was about the perspective of the season, where Leicester City were, and and fans shouldn't have got carried away with the defeats to Manchester City and to Liverpool, and to maybe judge again and have a look after that West Ham result. And even if it hadn't gone Leicester's way, they'd still be third in the Premier League. They are now second in the Premier League heading into 2020. Yeah, it's fantastic.
Absolutely. I just sort of want to say, you know, you need perspective. You watch the Liverpool game. Obviously, Liverpool's struggled last night against Wolves, but in general, they've only lost one game in something like 18 months, Liverpool. And Man City are the defending champions. And at times this season, and against Leicester, were electric. Simple as that. So you've got to put that into perspective as far as where Leicester City are. But, you know, when you look at the gap between a club like West Ham, who have spent a lot of money, and a club like Leicester, who have also spent a decent amount of money as well. You know, you can't deny that. You know, there's like 23 points difference in the table, and that just shows you how far this team is coming in such a short space of time. Now they are slightly behind the Man Cities and the Liverpools of this world, but how long has Pep Guardiola been in the job? How long has Jurgen Klopp been in the job at Liverpool? And he's moulded his team. He's got the players that he wants, and now you're seeing the rewards of that. Brendan's 10 months into his job. So it's going to take time. It just shows that it does take time. But without a shadow of a doubt, Leicester City are on the right path to becoming a consistent force in the Premier League. If you look down the table, every other team is just full of inconsistencies throughout the season. And that's why Leicester City are in second place, because they're consistent game after game after game. And there's no... I was going to say there's no shock, but there's no need to feel, you know, undermined or subhuman or whatever you want to call it. They're getting beat by teams like Liverpool and Man City because of the way these teams have been built and the time that the managers have been given. It's as simple as that. Leicester City are right on the right path and they're going places.
And they proved, Tony, as well, that they've got the squad to do so as well. I know... In that run of however many games, 9 games in a row that they had won, yes, a lot of those, 5 or 6, I think they'd gone without changing a member of the starting 11. People thought, oh, maybe it's just the 11 that can do it. Well, they proved on Saturday that the whole squad has got so much quality in it, and they went and won a Premier League game away from home as convincingly as they did.
Yeah, I agree with that, and I agree with what the boys have said. You know, I mean, this is a squad worthy of being in that top four now. You know, it's... There's a lot of cup games coming up, FA Cup, and obviously still in the League Cup as well. And it's really important, because you just never know when you're going to get injuries, when you're going to get suspensions. And there's no point in having a squad and then you then throwing in a player who hasn't played for 6 months. That's ridiculous. So I think, you know, it's really important what Brendan did. I admire him for it. It was a brave decision, but it certainly paid off on Saturday. And in terms of the league position, you know, I think it's a bonus if Leicester can sort of, you know, go between second and third and fourth, you know, that's sort of bonus position. But the main thing to look at is fifth position, Man United. They are 11 points clear in terms of trying to qualify for the Champions League. And that is, you know, to be there at the end of the year, you know, if you just said at the start of the season, Leicester are going to be 11 points clear for fifth position going into the new year, you know, Leicester fans would have been, you know, you'd have gone, wow, that we'll take that all day long. So it's been a marvellous achievement by the club.
Yeah, they'd have been absolutely delighted, as will, I'm sure, Brendan Rodgers. He spoke after the game at West Ham, as did Kelechi Iheanacho and Damari Gray.
I said to the players beforehand that this sport and football at the top level, you've got to be at your maximum and you've got to have that edge. And I thought we had that today in terms of our energy and attitude in the game, considering so many of the players that we brought into the squad. So I'm so happy for them. You know, they get a great reward, been hard for them, especially after the last game and then quickly to turn around. But they came here and played very, very well, and they thoroughly deserved the 3 points.
I was disappointed to miss, obviously, but it was early in the game and you can't, you know, get your head down. You got to keep going. And you know, I was confident throughout the game and, you know, I was confident I was going to get another opportunity and it come and just kept my cool and, you know, luckily it went in.
It was good and it was tough. So we're happy we got the 3 points and we're second in the league now, so we're happy.
We've got a really exciting time ahead. I said to the players, this is the first game of the second part of the season. You've been absolutely amazing. You know, you're sandwiched between, you know, two of the greatest clubs in Europe at this moment in time. So that shows you how well you've done. And now we've got to, we would want to start this year with a victory. And the players did that. And now we can recover a little bit and go up to Newcastle for another tough game.
You're listening to Extra Time, live on LCFC Radio. Your place for all the reaction to the weekend's football.
Yes, Brendan Rodgers, Kelechi Iheanacho and Damari Gray speaking after that 2-1 win at West Ham on Saturday. Ewan, as I said, one of the voices we heard there, Damari Gray, he said obviously he was disappointed missing the penalty, but he came back and he showed character to come back and not let his head drop, as he said.
And what a finish, by the way. Really cool finish. It was a really good goal. Perez carried it such a long way. Can't believe he wasn't closed down, but the way to pass was absolutely perfect for Damari to come on, and it was such a cool finish. And I don't know why, I was taking my mum back, she'd been with us for Christmas, and I was taking her back to North Wales and listening to the game in the car. And when I heard that Damari was going to take the penalty, I just didn't really fancy him. But he more than made up for it. And when your first penalty taker, he's not available, and obviously I think Madison would have taken it had he been on the pitch. Iheanacho, being a centre-forward, people think forward should take penalties. For one reason or another, he didn't. Damari Gray showed the confidence to get the ball, put it down. And to be fair, it was a decent save by Fabianski, who really shouldn't have been on the pitch to have been able to make the save.
Gerry, the one thing about Damari Gray reminded me a bit of Wilfred Ndidi, right at the beginning of the season. Remember Chelsea away, Ndidi, he made a mistake very, very early on, didn't he? But he responded and scored a header and it was 1-1 there and he redeemed himself almost for that mistake. And Damari Gray did a similar thing against West Ham. So what does that say about the character and strength of mind in this group?
Well, let's go back a bit and try and get inside the head of Damari Gray. What would he have done 12 months ago? In the exact same scenario, he probably would have let his head drop. He probably would have drifted out of the game. But with the help of Brendan Rodgers and his staff, then he's shown a new confidence in his game. Not an arrogance, it's confidence that he's brought. And you hear about him saying, you get your head down, you work hard. Hopefully you get another opportunity, then you put it right. And that's exactly what happened. But that's because he got his head down and he kept working hard for the team. So he's becoming a more rounded, more mature player all in all. It's not just about, you know, he took the penalty at Everton. It was probably the best penalty of the night, by the way, this penalty at Everton. One of the cleanest struck penalties, anyway, of the night. And that's probably why without Jamie being on the pitch, he was made number one penalty taker because his penalty was the best, I thought, against Everton in the shootout. And let's face it, we can all miss a penalty. I know TC will probably tell you that he never missed one. I know Ewan didn't take him.
I took a few, missed a few.
Well, there you go. But it's not easy standing there with a ball at your feet and just you and the keeper and a load of fans behind you. It's not easy. So you've got to credit Damari Gray for his maturity. And, you know, he's come on as a more mature player. And that's why you've seen him react the way he did.
Yeah, Tony, as a former forward yourself, obviously you and you were too, so you can come in on this as well. But when you strike, if you've missed a good chance that you feel like you should have put away, whether it was a penalty or whether it was a really good opportunity that 9 times out of 10 you'll score, does that play on your mind, Tony, as a player, or do you have to put it straight out of your mind, presumably like Damari Gray will have done at the weekend?
It can play on your mind, Dan. It's more so, listen, a penalty, a goalkeeper can always save a penalty, we know that. If you miss like a sitter, you know, one of those where you feel, how the hell have I missed that? It really can play on your mind. So you have to very quickly snap out of it. And as my dad always used to say to me, the next one, it's all about the next one, the next one, forget about it, next one. And you have to have that sort of single-mindedness to block it out. And that's not always easy if you're not what you would call a natural goal scorer. I look at Damari, he's an excellent player, but he's not a natural goal scorer. We know that. He's many other aspects of his game that he's really good at. He's not a natural goal scorer. So if you do miss the penalty like that, it is hard sometimes to get it out of your mind. One quick thing about the penalty, Dan. I think we need a rule change because Iheanacho was wiped out by the West Ham goalkeeper.
Yeah.
And then the trainer comes on the field of play to treat him, at which point he has to leave the field of play. Now, I don't know whether he wants the penalty taker for Leicester, but if he is, and I'm guessing he would have been, how unfair is that? That he's been fouled, the trainer comes on, he's got to leave the pitch, and Leicester are down to 10 men while they're taking the penalty. That is baffling me how that could be allowed to happen.
Yeah, no, it's a good point, actually, that I didn't think about.
But, I mean, I never really worried, because I missed so many. I didn't really worry about missing chances. Missing a penalty had a massive effect on me mentally. But as TC said, if you miss a sitter, you can't dwell on it for too long, because the next one could be coming on within the next few seconds, and you've got to be mentally right to be putting that away.
Does it not, though, as you're playing, say, the balls with your defence or the other team are on the attack and you're almost isolated as
you,
one
you
on the halfway line,
you must
be thinking
definitely.
And replaying
you
it
You think
in your
about
head.
It, what could he have done differently? Should he have gone to the other side? But you know, all the best players miss penalty. You can't worry about it too much. You've just got to make sure that you're right to stick the next one away.
I would say a good centre-forward or someone who, you know, backs himself in front of the goal, would back himself with the next chance.
Look at Jamie Vardy. He
exactly.
Obviously, he cares if he misses a penalty, but the way he plays, you would never think it affects him.
Well, look at Brighton away earlier this season. He missed that penalty, or the penalty saved. Maddison scored the rebound. Mm. It was then retaken. 2 minutes later, he slots the penalty. And I guess that's single-mindedness as a striker, and you're focused and you trust and your ability. But does that come, Tony, with experience? And the more you play, the more you think, yeah, I'll have another chance, because a younger player, Damari Gray is a young player, but a younger player than that, could something like that, missing a really good chance or missing a penalty, affect a younger player more than someone who's got the experience to move on from it?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Mm. I mean, you know, but you've got to admire him for taking the penalty. As I said, Iheanacho's up the pitch, so if you look around the team, there probably wasn't that many people, you know, willing to take a penalty. I've been in that position myself. I remember when I was playing for Everton and we got playing in the FA Cup at Chelsea, and I won a penalty and I sort of put the ball on the spot to wait for someone to take it, and everyone had turned their back and no one was taking the penalty. It was down to me. Of course, I took the penalty and missed it at Stamford Bridge. We got knocked out of the FA Cup and you're the four guys. So I wasn't afraid to do that, because I think, you know, when you're one of the more experienced players, you take the penalty. If you miss it, you know you're going to play in the next game and you know you're going to score goals. When you're a younger player, you don't always have that opportunity. So for Damari, you know, he's not been a regular in the side, as we know. He comes on, he's a very effective sub. So, you know, I admire him for, you know, having, you know, to step up and take the penalties. You know,
courage.
For that. Yeah, courage.
We'll go for that one,
Dan. Having scored a winning goal, he won't give it a second thought and no one else will.
Because he's gone on and scored
a winning goal. No one will batter an eyelid at the missed penalty.
Which is great, and probably and presumably a sign of the togetherness as well in the dressing room as well.
Yeah, you know, as soon as he's put that ball past Fabianski, he scored at the right end where all the Leicester fans were, and every single Leicester player joined him. You know, they knew he would have been hurting after missing the penalty, and they just wanted to celebrate that moment for Damari Gray, because it was a terrific finish.
Gerry, Iheanacho, obviously getting the opening goal for Leicester. A very different type of goal to the Damari Gray one, or a penalty. It was instinctive, wasn't it? The ball came and he nodded it in.
Well, yeah. And there's one player that we haven't mentioned. That's Ayoze Perez, who himself hasn't had the best at times, but he's had two assists. And as Ewan rightly pointed out, his ball for Damari Gray is inch perfect. Mm. He's on the run at pace. It's a difficult ball. It looks easy, but it's a difficult ball to get the pace of that pass right. And again, he was in the right place for Iheanacho's goal. What all good strikers do is come, one of them go round the back, just in case it's overhit. Well, it was.
Well, you wouldn't blame him for giving up on that.
Well, exactly, and he wasn't expecting that type of ball to come into the box—a big, loopy, floaty. Well, let's call it a cross, but you know it was a mishit cross, and he's made that run round the back, and without doing that, then that ball goes out for a goal kick. So, obviously, Kelechi is in a good area. He's in a good spot also at the back post just to tap it in. So, yeah, it's an easy finish, but it was something that was created nearly out of nothing because by Iosi Perez, because he had the foresight to make sure he run round the back post.
Typical centre-half. It's an easy finish. That's a typical centre-half thing to say, isn't it?
Well, I'd have finished that one.
I just thought it's arrived at his forehead before he knows it.
Yeah.
And he's got to react. He's got to get all the power into it. And he hasn't got any... You know, he's got to get all them neck muscles into the art of heading that ball. I thought it was a terrific finish. I really did. Because a split second, that's all he had to react to put that ball in the back of the net.
Yeah, Tony, do you think it was quite underrated then, the finish from Iheanacho? We've had Gerry says simple finish. We've had a terrific finish from Ewan. You got the casting vote, and I think I might know which way he's going to go.
I'm outnumbered here, so I'm not even going to
jump in, Dan. You know what's coming here. But what I thought was interesting, when the ball's looped up towards the far post, this shows you that Kelechi is for me, is much more of a goal scorer. When the ball's gone towards him, he's done what I would have done. I would have thought, well, I'm not going to head the ball back, because if you head the ball back, someone else will score.
Yeah.
So I'll let someone head the ball to me and I'll get in position. So if you watch his movement, he looks and he thinks, I can go and head that, but then no one's going to be in the middle to put the ball in the net. And it's actually a good bit of movement because he stops, adjusts his body. When it comes to him, it comes really quickly. And then, yes, it looks an easy finish, but it was actually a really, really good finish.
Oh, let's just call it world class. Was that difficult? We'll call it world class.
Yeah, you've been outvoted, I'm afraid, Gerry. One other quick word on Iosé Perez then, Ewan. As Gerry mentioned, you know, terrific play, completely different assists, weren't they, for both goals?
Yeah.
But what will that do for his confidence, do you think?
I've done the world of good. Didn't get on the score sheet, but, you know, assists, big things are made of them these days. And he's created the two goals. He played with the freedom. I think he played in the number 10 role, didn't he?
Yeah.
Which, you know, he hasn't done since he's been here. He's played on that wide right. But it just shows he's got another string to his bow. And two very, very good assists. He'll do the world of good.
Right, we've got to do our first weekend trivia of the evening before we go to the news break. So, you definitely need to write these answers down. And it is
answers.
It's a wild stab in the dark, I'd suggest this. So, Leicester played their 518th game at the weekend in the Premier League. So 518 games in the Premier League for Leicester City. How many goals have they scored in that time?
580.
I promise I won't come to you first, Tony. So have a little think. 518 games, how many goals? Gerry, you can go first.
1,050.
1,050.
That's a hell of a shout. That's two a game.
Okay, Tony.
Wow, I'm gonna have to split the difference somewhere in between of it. I'm gonna go for 850.
You've gone for 850, and what did you say?
572.
Quickly working it out. Yes, you and you are closest. It's 666.
Well,
the three sixes, 666. So that's 1.29 per game that Leicester
what'd
scored
go for?
In the Premier League.
Yeah.
Ambitious shout, Gerry.
Well, you know me.
Well, they scored nine in one game, haven't
exactly,
they?
Exactly. You know. But there you go.
We've yet to get any guesses in. Fee, you've said weekend trivia, yay, but you've not had a guess yet, so I wonder if it was a bit too difficult, that one. But well done, Ewan, for getting closest. You are 1-0 up in our weekend trivia. We've got weekend trivias 2 and 3 still to come. We'll also preview the New Year's Day trip to Newcastle United as well. Okay, well, we'll go to the news in just a moment. But, Gerry, we'll go back to that one more time. So, 1,050, that's... you think they scored nearly two a game?
Well, yeah. It was a guess, wasn't it? I should have went for 1.5, shouldn't I, or something like that there.
Yeah.
Yeah. That is just a pure guess.
Yeah, it was
really
a pure. Yeah. But I did. I was going to go for two a game, and then I thought, well, well, I've actually gone over two a game.
Got a bit more, big man.
Yeah, I know. But I was meaning to go a bit less. But there you go. The old grey matters.
See, I thought being a defender, you'd have gone quite
low. And I
forgot
about all the nil nils and all the nil ones and or one nils that they've had as well over the years, especially when I was playing every other game was a 1-0 TC on the score sheet. There was a lot of 1-0s and, you know, but so, hey, listen.
Just finally, how many of those 666 have you got?
What, goals?
Premier League goals for Leicester.
Oh, I don't know. 11 or 12, something like that.
It's good going, though. Yeah. It's good going, that.
It's more than me for Leicester in the Premier League.
Well, there we go. Mm-hmm. Right, the news is ready now, so we'll go to that and we'll then preview the Newcastle United trip just after that.
You're listening to LCFC Radio.
Lawyers for a British woman who's been found guilty in Cyprus of lying about being gang-raped says she's to appeal against the verdict. The 19-year-old from Derbyshire, who we can't name, insists she only dropped allegations against 12 Israelis after being pressured by police. Lawyer Nir Yaslovitz represents some of the boys she accused.
I hope the court will impose a harsh punishment to reflect the damage done to my client, and I hope that the story ended today in a very happy way.
Four people have been arrested across England by police investigating a terror plot. Officers say their operation is not linked to the London Bridge attack in November or any upcoming New Year's Eve celebrations. Two people have been taken to hospital after a large house fire in Folkestone. Smoke could be seen across the town in Kent as crews battled the flames in Weir Bay Crescent this afternoon. French authorities have rescued 19 suspected migrants from a small fishing boat in the English Channel. The group, made up of 16 men, a woman and two children, were picked up at around 10:30 last night. £3 billion has been promised to farmers to help them after Brexit. The Chancellor says it will help the sector thrive after the UK leaves the Common Agricultural Policy payment scheme next year. Annette Batters, president of the National Farmers Union, says this promise will ease workers' concerns.
Without, you know, this payment in place, you would see many businesses in dire straits. So it supports the whole volatility, market failure aspect. And it's a vital tool in managing risk effectively.
And Bumble has explained why it took down Sharon Stone's profile, saying users must have thought she was too good to be true. Earlier, the Basic Instinct star tweeted to say she'd been blocked from the dating app after several people reported her as fake. That's the latest. I'm Kat Suave.
Hi Leicester fans, it's Wes Morgan here.
It's Ricardo Pereira.
It's Johnny Evans.
I'm Ben Chilwell. You're listening to Extra Time on LCFC Radio.
Welcome back to Extra Time here on LCFC Radio with me, Dan Bates, Gerry Taggart, Iwan Roberts and Tony Cottee is dialed in from his home, which I hope, Tony, you've got the heating on and it's a bit warmer than us in the studio here. Where T-shirt isn't enough for me.
Nice and warm down here.
Right, let's do weekend trivia number two. We did it just before the news, so we'll do the second one now because it's the final word on West Ham before we look at the Newcastle game. So West Ham, Tony, you might stand a better chance in this one, have already lost as many home games this season as they had done in their previous two seasons. So in each of the last two seasons, they'd lost this many games, and they've already done it already this season at home. How many? How many home games have they lost this season? So if you write down your answers, but I will come to you first this time, please, Tony.
Yeah, I'm going to go for six.
Okay.
I'm going to go seven.
I'll go eight.
You'll go eight. No, Tony's bang on. It's
six.
Yeah.
Right.
So they lost six games in the 17-18 season, six games in the 18-19 season at home, this is, and they've already done it so far this season. And Tony, you probably don't want to, but we'll let you have that one quick word on West Ham. And obviously you were bitterly disappointed with the result. With your West Ham hat on, with your Leicester hat on, you were pleased. But are you interested now to see David Moyes coming in?
Yeah, I'm pleased, Dan. You know, I think they needed a change. You know, you look at football clubs, and we've seen quite a few in the Premier League this year.
and you look at the performances, you look at the mannerisms of the players, of the manager, and I think that's where West Ham were at the weekend. I think it was a really poor performance, so no surprise at all the manager left. In terms of David Moyes, I'm really pleased. I thought he was harshly treated last time. I thought he'd done a good job. He kept them up in the Premier League. And I felt that he deserved the chance to take the club on. Obviously, they chose Pellegrini, but he's been given a second chance. He's a nice guy, David. He knows his football. Very experienced manager. And I'm sure he'll certainly give the club enough points coming into the season to get them hopefully sort of towards mid-table. And then they can obviously look to rebuild for next season. So I think it's a good appointment.
Yeah, not too far to wait until Leicester play West Ham next, actually, here at King Power Stadium, Wednesday the 22nd of January. So those two fixtures have come very close. So it'll be interesting to see David Moyes' West Ham here at the King Power Stadium. Right, Newcastle United, Gerry, New Year's Day. Firstly, what's it like as a player? New Year's Eve and New Year's Day, because presumably you don't celebrate New Year's Eve, do you?
Christmas and New Year are just non-existent for players.
So do you just presumably go to bed in the hotel the night before the game, as you
normally
would?
Well, yeah, it depends whether or not you're playing at home or away, obviously, or whether you're away games down the road or an overnight stop. But yeah, that's it. Basically, treat it like any other game day or, you know, pre-game day. Yeah, it's non-existent, you know.
Has it become a little bit more for you now in retirement?
Oh, we make up for it now. Well, 20 years of not being able to go out.
Yeah.
So that's what the players who are playing now will have, you know, look forward to is...
You don't think about it, Tags, do you? You don't think about Christmas, you don't think about New Year, because you've got work to do. It's part and parcel of every season. We all have sacrifices to make in whatever we choose to do, and that was ours. You know, we spend a bit of time with the kids. We either go training in the morning for an hour or so, or you train at 5 o'clock on Christmas night before you travel away to a hotel.
Yeah. Well, I suppose, Tony, if that's all you knew as players, what you didn't really feel like you were missing anything then, I guess?
Well, the thing is, Dan, I mean, 1st of January is a special date for me, because I actually made my debut as a 17-year-old for West Ham on the 1st of Jan. 1983, 37 years ago, coming up, I can't believe it. So, but I remember I'd never been in the squad before, and we went into a hotel the night before on New Year's Eve, and I was rooming with a player that you'll probably remember, Alan Dickens, good young player, and we looked at each other when Big Ben Valley bombs, and we thought, what the hell are we doing here? We should be out partying with everyone else. But of course, what I didn't know was I was playing in the game the day after, because the manager hadn't told me. So, I agree with what the boys say. They do Christmas, New Year, you just get on with it. It's another time of the year that everyone's celebrating, but you're just focused on your training and your preparation and trying to get as many points in the bag over, you know, normally there's at least four games in terms of league games, and you just want to get as many points as possible.
It's just about getting through it, isn't it, this period? You know, your mindset as a player is just get through it. Get as many points, as Tony said, but get through it. Hopefully you don't get sent off, you don't get injured. You're hurting physically, you are hurting. There's no doubt about it. So you just, all your mindset is just get through it. One more game. Just one more game and then I've got a couple of days off. You know, that's the way it works.
You have your Christmas party and that's it. Then your mind's on the job in hand, the games that you've got coming up.
And you try and do that early in December as well.
Yeah. Get it then as soon as you can.
You can focus. Focus then, Gerry, is on St James's Park, of course, for Leicester City.
Yeah.
It'll be a tough game, won't it? Newcastle have certainly picked up since we saw them last here at King Power Stadium. So how do you see that one going? Leicester obviously making so many changes.
Tough game, yeah. But, you know, Newcastle, I think, have lost their last two on the bounce. They've lost five of their last 10. They've only drawn one, which is a significant stat, I think. So they either win or they lose the majority of their games. And so that's pretty even, Stephen, you would say. You know, won four, lost five out of their last 10, only drawn one. So, another team that very, very up and down. Yes, Steve Bruce has sort of steadied the ship somewhat since the beginning of the season, but, you know, we've seen with the last couple of games, getting beat at home to Everton, obviously getting beat to Manchester United away, that, you know, there's nothing to fear for Leicester City when they go there.
Yeah, I guess, Tony, that one draw that Gerry was alluding to in those last five last 10 games rather, was at St James's Park. It was against Manchester City. It was that 2-2 game. And probably maybe that's the one that Brendan Rodgers is saying to his team, look, they can hurt the big teams in this division at home.
Well, they can. I mean, listen, St James's Park has always been a hostile place to go to, a difficult place. And it doesn't matter what sort of form the club's in. It's always hard to go there and get the 3 points. When you've got someone like Andy Carroll in the team, you've always got that aerial threat that you know that even if you're winning 1-0 with sort of 5 minutes to go, you know they're going to bombard you and get the ball into the box. So you know they've got different aspects to their team, I think, but they are very hit and miss. I mean they sort of beat Palace 1-0 the other week, and how they beat Palace I don't know, because they had so many chances. Obviously lost to Everton as well, so you don't really know what you're going to get from Newcastle. I know what I'm going to get from Leicester. I don't really know what I'm going to get from Newcastle other than Andy Carroll will pose a severe threat on the day.
Sometimes, though, Ewan, that's quite a scary proposition to go to, though. If you don't know what you're going to get from a team, you might end up getting a team that's right on it from the beginning.
And they'll, you know, as Tags were saying with the stats, I think they have lost 3 of the last 4 games now, Newcastle. It could be a good time for Leicester to play them. But they're 7 points better off now than they were this time last year under Rafa Benitez. So you have to give Steve Bruce an enormous amount of credit. They're good at home. I think 16 of their 25 points have come at St James's Park. So, you know, that tells you quite a bit. But they struggle to score goals. I think only Palace and Watford have scored less than Newcastle in the Premier League. They've bought heavily. You know, Joe Linton, I think he's only got 1 in 20. They play with 5 at the back. They play with, obviously, 3 centre-halves. And I can see Leicester going there and taking advantage of the system that they play, unless, obviously, Steve Bruce changes things.
Who will the Leicester defence need to be looking out for, Gerry? Obviously, Tony mentioned there Andy Carroll. He looked on it against Everton, didn't quite get a goal, but he looked a handful. Then you've got Almiron. He scored, didn't he?
Yeah, I think early they're a big side, aren't they? You know, they've got, you know, like say Carroll, Joe Linton, you've got Lascelles at the back as well, Shaw, they're all a threat from set pieces especially. And then they've got some decent little footballers in Almiron. The young kid who's just come on.
Longstaff,
who scored against Manchester United, you know, so he's got a goal in him. But I think, you know, if you go to, there's not one player who really springs to mind and goes, you know, as Ewan said, they don't score a lot of goals. Now, so that tells you that defensively they're pretty solid. Yeah, the keeper's decent, although he has been known to, you know, mishandle a few. But so defensively they're pretty decent. They don't run away, you know, they don't steamroll
their games,
don't
they? They nick games.
And then on the odd occasion against the likes of a Man City, they pull out a top draw performance and bag 2 goals. So it depends, you know, it all depends how they sort of see this game, which I'm sure they'll see it as a massive game for them. And they'll need a result after winning, having back-to-back losses. And especially with the last one coming at home.
They've only conceded 9 goals at St James's Park in the 10 games. That's a good record.
Yeah, that tells you that they're pretty solid.
They're organised, they're disciplined. They just try and nick a 1-0 or a 2-1. I think John Joe Shelby's their top scorer from midfield with 2 or 3, and he's not played every game.
Yeah, it'll be an interesting game, I think. And Tony, you were here, of course, earlier in the season for the 5-0 at King Power Stadium, Leicester against Newcastle. So that'll probably be a big part of Steve Bruce's team talk, won't it? The fact that happened here and they'll be wanting to right that wrong, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, that will never change your football, Dan. I mean, if you get a walloping somewhere, you know full well that as long as it's the same manager there, that the first thing Bruce is going to say there, we owe these one, boys. They beat us 5-0, it could have been a lot worse, you know. I know there was a sending off in the game and it changed it a little bit, but, you know, it was a wonderful performance from Leicester, and Newcastle were pretty poor in the end. So, you know, but he won't need to do too much of a team talk. It'll just be, look, you know, we need the points and let's go out and let's get, you know, get our own back to what happened early in the season.
Yep, let's hope it goes well. Obviously, New Year's Day, you can listen to the full game on LCFC Radio. It's a 3 o'clock kickoff New Year's Day, which means our coverage starts at 12 o'clock on New Year's Day. So we'll all be fresh and ready for that one ourselves. Last week on Extra Time, we picked Leicester City's Premier League team of the decade, so we don't need to do anything like that. But we've asked the three of you to think about some of Leicester City's best memories of the decade or best moments of the decade. Those of you listening in on Facebook, on Twitter, do get your suggestions in as well. There's a few very, very obvious ones in there, of course. Lifting the Premier League title at King Power Stadium, I'm sure will be the top of many people's list, Gerry, for moment of the decade. But we've asked you to pick maybe a different one that involves a game or a...
I think someone asked me this the other day, and I said it was Andrea Bocelli singing on King Power. I thought that was awesome. That was one of the highlights. But if you're on about a game or a moment, then I suppose beating Seville in the last, they get through the quarterfinals of the Champions League, it was just crazy, isn't it? Quarterfinals of the Champions League.
And the atmosphere that...
Oh, it was frightening. Absolutely frightening. What a game. What a game it was as well here. You know, in the second leg, it was...
Was it like a classic Champions League tie, wasn't it?
Oh, it had everything, didn't it? Just Kasper Schmeichel was in inspired form that evening as well. Yeah, it was a great evening.
Ewan?
I think your first Champions League game, going away from home to Club Bruges and battering them 3-0.
Yeah,
you know, what a statement that was from Leicester. And, you know, when you're looking for highlights, you just get drawn to your title-winning season. And I think two games for me stand out. I think you played Liverpool Man City early in the February. You beat Liverpool 2-0 here, Vardy getting both goals. That one ridiculous strike from about 25 yards from an impossible angle. And then 4 days later, you go up to the Etihad and you beat them 3-1. And I thought that was a proper statement from Leicester. And that's when I think everybody took note as if they've got an absolutely magnificent chance of winning this Premier League title.
Fee says on Facebook, winning the Premier League in 2016 was her favourite memory. Brad says Nugent chasing a squirrel was his funniest moment of the decade.
I missed that one.
Squirrel will be bigger.
Tony, then, what are your standout moments, you think, for Leicester this decade?
Well, I've gone for a couple, Dan. One, you have just already touched on. I think the away win at Man City in the title-winning season, because I think there were so many questions, you know, can Leicester keep doing it? Will they finish in the top four, top three, top two? Will they win it? And I think when they won that game at Man City, I think everyone went, wow, this is the real deal. And I think that was a real statement from the football club. And the other one I'm going to go for is a much more recent one. And that involved my debut as a commentator for LCFC. And that was Southampton 0, Leicester 9, which was an incredible...
How could we forget that?
Incredible game. And, you know, I went there to do the commentary expecting Leicester to maybe get a victory, but I don't think anyone in football would have seen that result coming. And, you know, I think that was, again, an incredible achievement.
I guess the thing with that one, Tony, is that because it's happened so recently to now, right at the very end of the decade, not many people would look at it. Had that happened, for instance, in 2013, it's something that when you look back, you think, oh, that was a standout moment for a lot of people. But because it happened only recently, it's not quite one of those types of memories. But I think, I'm sure it will be when it comes to Leicester's best moments in the Premier League. That'll be right up there, won't it?
Oh, yeah, without a doubt. And I mean, if you try and put it in perspective, I mean, we're now, what is it, 27 years of the Premier League, and there's only ever been two scores of 9 recorded. But Manchester United did it in the home game. Leicester did it in an away game. Now, you know, as the boys will tell you, to try and get even 3 or 4 goals away from home is so hard in the Premier League. So to get, you know, to start going 5, 6, 7, 8 and then 9, you know, albeit against 10 men, forget that fact, just to even get that amount of goals in one football match, you know, I think, you know, once we get 4, 5, 6 years down the line, everyone will look back and go, do you remember that 9-0? You know, because it was such a tremendous night.
Yeah, absolutely. Fantastic evening down on the South Coast. We've had a serious answer from Brad, Gerry. He says, Andy King scoring the winner against West Ham at the start of the Great Escape, at the start of that run. Mm-hmm. And that really did almost project that the beginning of that run, didn't it? That was such a vital win to get
late absolutely.
On.
You know, that was, you know, it was people... Well, I'm glad Brad brought that up, because that in itself, that form... At the back end of that season, literally just carried on.
It was
championship form, and they brought that form into the next season, which was obviously the title-winning season. So, yeah, you know, there was some great games. Was it 3-2 at West Brom as well?
With Vardy.
That was an unbelievable game of football as well. You know, the pressure, the tension, you know, it's palpable. You know, so there's some great games.
That run of games, and obviously staying up as miraculous as it was, Ewan, was, as Jerry said, the springboard for the title-winning season the next. So that summer obviously was very important to keep the same momentum and feel going.
Yeah, very important. And I can remember coming to a game here in the second half of that season when you were scratching and you were fighting for your lives. And Swansea played here, and I think you were 3 up after half an hour. And that's how you played that second half of that season, and that's how you got the amount of points and the amount of victories that you did, because you were flying, especially at home, you were flying out of those dressing rooms and you were getting two early goals and not taking your foot off the pedal. And as you say, you didn't really want the summer to come, you just wanted to carry on into that, and basically you did that. You know, the way that you finished that season, you carried on with the momentum and the confidence into that Premier League winning season.
Gerry, I asked you just before we came on, didn't I? Do you think you could name all the managers, the permanent ones that Leicester have had in the decade? You said easily. So go on, reel them off.
Well, okay.
Find his page.
Right, well, Nigel Pearson started the beginning of the decade.
Yeah.
And then he got the sack. Then Paulo Sousa came in. Yeah?
Yeah.
And then Paulo left.
Yeah.
Then Sven came in. Then Sven left. Then Nigel came back in.
Correct.
Then Nigel left again. Then Claudio Ranieri came in. He won the title. Then Claudio left. Then Craig Shakespeare came in. And then Craig left. And then Claude Puel came in. And he left. And then our saviour, the Northern Irish saviour of football, Brendan Rodgers, is now manager here.
And what a job he's doing.
And what a great job he's doing.
Can I just say as well, Nigel Pearson had a great start at Watford, hasn't he?
Yeah.
Oh, brilliant.
7 points from his first 3 games.
And he was
They'll be all right now, I think.
He was written off as well, wasn't he, Nigel? So fair play to him.
Yeah.
It just shows you that, you know, you don't become a bad manager overnight.
No, Tony, you and West Ham, you'll be hoping for a similar bounce in change of manager with David Moyes coming in, I'm sure, then.
Yeah, I think there will be. You know, it's not going to be easy. They've got a really tough game January the 1st. They're playing at home to Bournemouth, which will be, they're one place above West Ham. So that's a real relegation dogfight. And then they've got away to Gillingham in the FA Cup with Steve Evans as manager. That's not going to be easy. So, you know, it's going to be a baptism of fire for David Moyes, but I do believe he'll get the troops rallied up, and I think we'll see West Ham push up towards mid-table by the end of the season.
Right, let's go to our last Fox stand-in, because we're coming towards the end of the show. This is the game that we all talk about, Gerry. Yeah. Brad's laughing at your "our saviour." He says love it tags as well for Brendan Rodgers. Just as you've done that, unfortunately, yes, we do have to do last Fox standing, so let's do it.
That's what it is.
Gerry and Ewan are just debating which way round in this order we are going.
I'm just thinking of Tony. Tony Cottee sat at home.
wondering
when he's going to answer a question.
No, he's going to go last.
Right, our last Fox standing theme is the last one of the year, the last one of the decade. If you've not listened and not know how this works, we each have to take it in turns to do an answer from this theme, this sheet of paper that I've just been handed here. So let's see what we've got.
No peeping, Ian.
So it's the scorers of 5 or more Premier League goals this season. So scorers of 5 or more Premier League goals this season. Are you happy with that, Tony?
I'm happy, but I won't be lasting too long this one, I think.
Right, you can go first then, Tony, if you want.
I'll go for the easy one, Jamie Vardy.
Jamie Vardy is correct. I will then say Tammy Abraham.
Harry Kane.
Marcus Rashford.
Tony. Raheem Sterling.
Mane.
Salah.
Firmino.
Danny Ings.
Timu Pukki.
Oh, good one.
I'm struggling now.
Martial.
Not sure about this one. Aguero.
Yeah, I had that one written down. Richarlison. Ewan.
Jesus.
Oh, Gabriel Jesus, good answer.
Chris Wood.
Ashley Barnes.
Oh no. Yeah, I've literally just written that one down. I'm gonna have to be quick here. I'm going to take a gamble that Kevin De Bruyne has got five.
Oh, where's he pulled that from? Son?
Killed me. That's the one I have. Calvert-Lewin.
Oh,
great answer, Gerry. Great answer. Tony.
Yeah, please thank you and good night for me. McBurney.
Ollie McBurney? No. Unlucky, Tony. We say goodbye to you. I'm going to say Lacazette.
I've mentioned him earlier. John Joe Shelby.
No way.
No? Oh, wow. No way, good, get in!
I'm very surprised he has. Well done. Well done.
James Madison.
Mm. Yeah, that one next, Gerry. Oh, good answer. That shocked me, that one, Ewan.
It's the flak machines are up, Ewan, now, aren't
they? Yeah, could be struggling. Could be struggling. Oh, I'll go Wilson, Bournemouth.
What's his first name? Because there's two there.
Harry. Harry Wilson. Ewan.
Todd Cantwell.
Good answer.
I'll go Callum Wilson. See me out, mate. Next time.
That'll win it, you. That'll win it, you.
Josh King.
Oh, that's.
That's me gone. So there's two of you left. Ewan and Gerry left.
Nah, I don't know. I'm...
Are you passing? You might as well guess. You got to guess a name. You can't give him a name by default. A win by default. Ten seconds, and if you don't, Gerry takes it.
I can't think. Come on! I can't think!
No, don't think. Let me win this.
Five, Danny four, three, Danny two, one. We've had it, Tony. We've had it. No, I've got nothing for Tony. Tony's
one.
Out. Gerry, you've won by default.
Thank you.
Have you got an answer to...
Delafeu?
Oh. We don't know. Well, Delafeu would have been... It's wrong anyway, but it doesn't matter. Gerry is the winner of Last Fox Standing this evening.
Well done.
And the last one of the year, the last one of the decade.
Even sweeter. Even sweeter.
Well done, Gerry Taggart. Right, we are at 7 o'clock, so we do need to say goodbye. Thank you very much to our guests, Ewan Roberts, Gerry Taggart, and Tony Cottee.
Thank you very much, cheers, everyone.
That was listening as well and commenting in and having a few guesses as well in our game at the end. Thank you very much for that. Everybody have a fantastic New Year. We'll be back, of course, for the Newcastle game on New Year's Day. Our coverage starts at 3 o'clock. But thank you and have a great New Year.
That went quite a long time, that.